This may come as a surprise to many of you, but I've actually never properly used Linux before. I know, shocking stuff, but in my mind, Linux has just been a disease you contract staring at spreadsheets too long. But that disgust probably comes from my only interactions with Linux being me just trying to a clockwork orange it onto a device it's not compatible with. Of course it was horrible. Linux is a very horrible thing. But recently, I've started becoming more and more Linux curious, and then in my last video, when again I tried to a clockwork orange some Linux onto a device it wasn't compatible with, I thought I should probably try Linux on something that isn't the tech equivalent of those barnacles that grow on crab penises. So in today's video, me, a professional tech noob, is gonna do my first proper venture into some Linuxing. So what I'm gonna do is install Linux on the most recent gaming system I built, which is this one. And the system in question is the all AMD build I did a couple of videos ago, which has a 7600 X3D in it with a whole bunch of RAM, and this fabulous looking Yestin RX 9060 XT. And then compare the experience to the trusty old syphilitic leper that is Windows. And depending on how it goes, I may actually commit by the end of this video to using Linux on my personal system at home. But that's only if it goes well. So not to pressure you here, Linux, but there's quite a lot riding on this experience for you. Because if it goes well, you may gain one whole idiot. Very exciting. Now the first thing we need to do is decide on a distro for me to use, which according to Wikipedia is an operating system that includes the Linux kernel for its kernel functionality, which is of course a very helpful explanation. But as far as I understand it, the distros are basically just different versions of Linux, which is a little bit different to the process with Windows. I guess there are different versions of it. You can choose between like home and pro and stuff, which for my use case, aside from the inclusion of the borderline hindrance that is BitLocker and the higher price, the two are functional. Identical. Whereas with Linux, I feel like which distro you go with is a little bit more consequential. Now, I'm not going to walk you through the pros and cons of various distros, because if you haven't been able to tell up until now, I have no idea. And there is also a borderline infinite amount of these, which is a little intimidating at first sight. But I did, in my last video, try out a couple of distros, and it did help me make up my mind. Now, the first distro that I used was Arch Linux, and Yeah, I know, I'm good. I'm probably not gonna use that one. Now, instead of using Sweatlord Linux, I've decided to make the process about as easy for me as I think I could make it for me, by going with Bazite, which is a very specific gaming distro of Linux. Bazite is designed for people who want to game and are new to Linux. It's supposed to be pretty easy to set up and have good hardware compatibility. I also like that it seems to be a community-led project. I have pretty high hopes for this. So with that, let's get into my first category of comparing Linux to Windows, the installation process. Installing Windows 11 feels a little bit like being that old man in No Country for Old Men who has to flip a coin. You're pretty sure that if you click on the wrong thing, Windows 11 is gonna eat your liver. At least that's the case when setting it up. The installation process is pretty straightforward, but my general rule of thumb for the setup process is to channel your inner Amish and just say no to all of it. Oh, and if you give Windows 11 access to the internet while setting it up, you've screwed up and you're gonna have to start again. There's just no two ways about it. So what you do when you get to the bit where it begs for internet is you press Shift F10, type in this code, I always forget it, but this code lets you say I don't have internet when it resets back to that screen, and then you can set it up without internet, which means that it doesn't force a whole bunch of annoying services down your throat. Oh, and the process of making bootable Windows 11 media is also pretty straightforward. You just go onto the tool on their website and it'll make it for you. But this will give you a bit of a bloated Windows install out of the box. Well, how does Linux compare to this process? Well, with Bazite, it's actually really straightforward. You go onto Bazite's website and there's a tool that lets you configure an ISO for you to download. It asks you what graphics card you have in your system so that it actually pre-sets up drivers for you and stuff. That's really cool. And then once once you've downloaded the ISO, you use a tool called Rufus to flash it onto a USB to make like a bootable media, which is super easy. You just choose the ISO and then it does it for you. Other than that, the installation process is very similar to Windows 11's installation process. But then once it's installed, you don't have that setup process where it's Jeffrey Dahmer's you or whatever. So that's really good. It just goes straight from the installation into the operating system. And just like that, we've got some Bazite running. This is the first time I've seen Linux running on like a proper computer. It comes with Firefox pre-installed, that's nice. We don't have to fight off any of Edge's advances, we've just got the correct browser on here. Steam's also pre-installed. In fact, when you're choosing the ISO, you can have it just boot straight into big screen Steam mode. So then it'll kind of function like Steam OS, which is pretty cool. I then tried to have a look at AMD's driver suite situation for Linux, but was a little bit disappointed by what I found. Okay, that's interesting. So you don't have access to the Adrenaline software suite in Bazite, and it seems like it isn't compatible with most Linux environments. Like, this driver download is just the drivers, as far as I understand it. So it means that a lot of the features that are included in that software suite, you're gonna have to figure out workarounds to get working, which is a bit of a bummer. Luckily, I was able to find replacements for some of the features like screen capture using GPU screen recorder, Mango HUD for performance overlays or like an MSI Afterburner replacement, and LACT for GPU overclocking. Although LACT wasn't super happy with our graphics card and didn't give us many overclocking options. It pretty much just gave me the option to play around with power usage limits. So I think the next step is for me to download a bunch of games, a process which happened way faster than I was expecting. Whoa, look at those download speeds. I think this is pretty much the first time I've ever seen Steam just saturate my internet line. That's crazy. I often have issues with Steam downloading really slowly on Windows, but look at that. Is that like a Linux thing? That's crazy. Apparently it's not a Linux thing, I just happened to catch Steam on a good day because I tested it again on a Windows system and was getting slightly lower speeds but similarly fast compared to normal. My overlay isn't working, which required a quick Google. But it turns out for every game you want the Mango overlay showing up on, you just have to add a code to the properties of the game in Steam. Wow, we've got 230 frames per second happening here. It does feel very good. I mean, we're actually getting 100% GPU utilization apparently, which is interesting, that never happens. CS2 is infamous for ignoring big parts of your graphics card, but here it was running very well. On first impression, I was blown away by the Linux gaming experience. 1% 173? What? Another shocking thing was how Mango HUD displays its benchmark information. What an unbelievably stupid way to present data. It color codes all of the labels in, I don't know, I'm guessing that's alphabetical order, and then it shifts over to the actual results over here. Who came up with this? Why does it do that? Wait, there has to be a way to change this, because that is maybe the dumbest thing I've ever seen. But despite a bunch of admittedly blind clicking around, I couldn't figure out how to get it to display the numbers next to its corresponding label, you know, in like a list fashion. So please let me know down below how to fix this abomination.
Look at that, it's just like a clump of numbers. Like, say, what?
Data outrage aside, how does CS2's Linux performance compare to Windows? Well, straight off the bat, Windows does have a slightly lower GPU utilization. It doesn't have that impressive 100% we were seeing with Linux, which translates into a slightly lower average frame rate at 1440p low settings. What is interesting though is Linux has the advantage when it comes to 1% lows. The frame rate doesn't dip as much, it's more stable in Linux, which is really cool. Let's see if that result also translates to Cyberpunk.
Cyberpunk at 1440p ultra settings, doing pretty good. We're gonna need to see the comparative benchmarks with Windows, but I kind of remember it running better than this on the Windows system when I tested it a while ago. This does not seem as high as we were getting before. I mean, it is ultra at 1440p, and we are getting around 60.
Now, unfortunately with Cyberpunk, Linux falls a bit behind Windows 11 in both the average and 1% lows. The game is definitely still playable on Linux, but there is a bit of a performance impact versus Windows, a delta which gets much bigger once you turn ray tracing on for some reason. A result I wasn't really expecting. I didn't think just turning ray tracing on would take the performance delta from being kinda small to an absolute dumpstering.
So Doom Eternal also running pretty well. This is at 1440p with FSR native AA. So we are actually rendering at 1440p here, which is a little bit out of the game's comfort zone. And you can tell it's like 50 frames per second that we've got going here. It's not the highest frame rate ever, but you know, this is usable. Because of how this engine kind of functions, this is feeling okay. I'm curious to see how it's gonna compare to the Windows result though, because I'm pretty sure there's always ray tracing on with this game. And from our Cyberpunk results, it does seem like that is something that that Linux doesn't prefer.
It does seem to track. We lost a whole 10 frames per second going with Linux in Doom the Dark Ages. It seems like there's a bit of a performance issue with newer games, but the game was still very playable on Linux.
Okay, I'm excited to see how Stalker runs because, well, this is a very demanding game. It's running pretty good. We're doing alright, we're doing okay. We're just under 60 frames per second, so this again is like a similar result to what we were getting with Cyberpunk. This is running with AMD FSR using native AA. So like with Doom the Dark Ages, we are rendering in 1440p here. And yeah, I'd say this is usable. There is a little bit of squiggling going on in our frame time graph, but it feels aight.
And with Stalker 2, we see the gap close significantly in performance compared to the last two games. The gaming experience here feels virtually indistinguishable between the two operating systems. And with this result, when you turn FSR quality on, the gaming experience is perfectly usable at 1440p.
So that's jumped us up to about 80 frames per second, although there is some stuttering going on. Like the game, it's not the most stable frame rate, but this is playable now. We're at the point where I wouldn't be too offended to play the game like this.
And then finally, in terms of the compatibility with the games that I often play on my free time, Dota ran perfectly well, there were no issues there, and DayZ also was very usable on the Linux system. Which is good news. If I switch to Linux, I can still happily play punching zombies through an open window simulator. Having said that, I couldn't get Escape from Tarkov running. I got the actual installer downloaded, but it wouldn't get further than the start of the installation process. But honestly, being forced to not suffer in Escape from Tarkov is, if anything, a selling point of Linux for me. So with that, I am now officially going to install Linux on my private system at home and use it for at least a month before making a follow-up video. So subscribe to the channel if you don't want to miss that video. And until the next video, thank you for watching. Bye-bye.